glad to see you here in the house of the Lord this morning. Glad that you're here. It's a great way to start the service with Brother Aaron following the Lord in believers' baptism. Great to see his friends here with him this morning. We welcome every one of you that are here with us, part of our Castleberry family, and our guests that are here this morning. Thank you all for being a part of our service this morning. We're studying through the Gospel of John, and we are going through the 18th chapter. Jesus has been arrested by the Pharisees, the religious leaders of Israel, during this day. He's been put on trial by them, and they're getting ready to push him through these trials. And after they convict him and they declare him guilty, they plan to get him crucified on a cross. They want to put him to death. The religious leaders of Israel, most respected religious people of Jesus' day, are the ones who headed up the crusade to convict and murder the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we're in Luke chapter 18. We're in the middle of all that. Luke chapter 18, beginning in verse number 33. Luke 18, 33. If you look at it with me. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate it. I haven't had my Taco Bueno today, so I'm a little behind. Anyway, it is the Gospel of John. Thank you. Thank you. Even the guests were correcting me there, and I appreciate that. I need it. So John chapter 18, beginning verse 33. Let's look at it together. The Bible says, then Pilate entered the praetorium. That's a courthouse, the courthouse that the Romans had established there in Israel, because Rome was ruling over the world right now, and they were ruling over Israel during that time. And so this is the courthouse where Pilate made decisions. And Pilate entered the praetorium again. He's been outside talking with the chief priests and the Pharisees, who are telling him that Jesus is guilty, he needs to be put to death. And now he goes back in, he starts to talk to Jesus. It says he entered the praetorium again, he called Jesus, he said to him, are you the king of the Jews? Jesus answered him, are you speaking this for yourself about this, or did others tell you this concerning me? Pilate answered, am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you to me. What have you done? Jesus answered, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now my kingdom is not from here. Pilate therefore said to him, are you a king then? Jesus answered, you say rightly that I am a king. For this cause I was born. For this cause I have come into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. Pilate said to him, what is truth? When he had said this, he went out again to the Jews and said to them, I find no fault in him at all. But you have a custom that I should release someone to you at the Passover. Do you therefore want me to release to you the king of the Jews? Then they all cried again, saying, not this man, but Barabbas. Barabbas was a robber. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, today we love you and we thank you for your word. And we pray now, Lord, that you will open our hearts to receive the message that you have for us in this place. I don't believe that any of us are here by accident this morning. I believe that you have shaped our lives. You created and fashioned our lives to the most intimate details, Lord. And we thank you, Father, for your grace and your blessings on us, that you have us here to hear a message from you this morning. We pray, Father, that your word will ring forth true and that we'll be touched in our hearts by it, that we'll be changed by your word today. Use your word to transform our hearts. And we pray it in the precious name of Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. Amen. So we make our way down here. We're getting down to the end of this 18th chapter, John chapter 18. We make our way down here this morning. We're witnessing some of the most wicked kinds of deeds that men are capable of committing. As the religious leaders of Israel are carrying out their plans to murder Jesus Christ, the Son of God. We're seeing the most wicked acts in the world as they plan to murder Jesus Christ. And yet at the same time, we're also witnessing, while we see these wicked deeds, we're also witnessing the perfect, the glorious, the righteousness and the holiness of our Lord Jesus Christ as he humbly submits himself to his father's plan, and he obediently allows himself to be arrested, and he allows himself to be falsely accused and assaulted by, and beaten and condemned to death by wicked men. Jesus simply surrenders to all that. He has a plan. This is an illegal sham of a trial that's been carried out in secret, during the middle of the night, during the trial before Annas. Remember, there were no witnesses. Not weren't even any witnesses at all during the trial before Caiaphas. There were only false witnesses that came forward, but their stories were not consistent, so they couldn't hold up. And yet these wicked religious leaders of Israel have made the decision to go ahead and condemn Jesus Christ to death anyway, even though they have no evidence, even though they have no witnesses. And that's what they've been doing during the night. Just as the sun was beginning to come up very early on the next morning, they led Jesus here to the Roman governor, Pilate. And the reason they took him before Pilate is because they hated Jesus so much. You know, Pilate gave them permission. He said, take him out and deal with him according to your own law. And that would have meant that as Israelites, they would have taken him out to a cliff and tossed him off or taken him to a pit. They would have thrown him in the pit and they would have thrown large stones on him. They would have stoned him to death. That would be the way that they would put someone to death under their own law. But they weren't happy with this. These men hated Jesus so much that they wanted to make an example out of him. You know, he had come into their temple and turned over the money tables, and he had exposed them as crooked because they were misusing the house of God, and they were squeezing the people for money, and it was all about them being in the spotlight. And so they had been exposed by Jesus in this, and Jesus stopped, at least interrupted the money from flowing into their crooked organization. And so they're angry with him. They hate Jesus, and so they want him to die, but they don't just want him to die. They want him to be put to death in the most shameful and humiliating way, in the most painful way possible. They want him to die by crucifixion. They hate him that much. It just so happens that Jerusalem was under the Romans at the time, and Rome put people to death by crucifixion. And so they're appealing to Pilate at this time. There were plenty of other times in the Bible when the Jews stoned people, even though they claimed that they weren't allowed to by Rome, but they stoned people many times. But Jesus, they're not going to be happy with that. They want him to die by that gruesome act of crucifixion. They want him to suffer. They want him to suffer. One of the most bizarre things about this is that when they brought Jesus before Pilate, and Pilate begins to speak with them about what he's done, they didn't even have a clear accusation against Jesus. They couldn't tell Pilate what Jesus had done. When Pilate asked them what he was guilty of, they just said, we wouldn't have brought him if he weren't an evildoer. They just said, he's an evildoer. You just got to trust us. And it really speaks volumes about how pathetic the character of these religious leaders were. But it also speaks volumes about how pathetic the morals and how much of a weakling of a politician this man Pilate is, because Pilate, if he heard that they didn't even have a clear accusation against Jesus, and he allows this trial to go forward, even though there were no witnesses and they couldn't even explain the charges or why they wanted to put him to death, and Pilate just goes ahead and goes with it, because they know that he's a weakling of a politician, that he will compromise, and they know how to manipulate him into getting their way because they've done it before. They know this guy Pilate. And so we see kind of who Pilate is by allowing this trial to go forward, because Pontius Pilate was a man who did not have the courage to make the tough decisions. And these Pharisees know that, and that's why they're pushing him. They've come to him, and they want Jesus to be put to death. Pilate is only allowing this to go forward because the Pharisees are putting pressure on him. And we're going to see that very clearly as we go through this study today. So I want you to notice four things in this passage of Scripture that we've read this morning. Number one, I want you to notice the unwarranted accusation. So if you're taking your notes on the back of your bulletin, you'll see that outline there. That's number one, the unwarranted accusation. And here's what Pilate says to Jesus in verse 33. Pilate entered the praetorium again, called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Remember the Jews in the trial before Caiaphas, they decided at the end, even though they didn't have any witnesses, and even though none of the stories of their witnesses matched up, it wasn't consistent. Even though they didn't have the evidence, they concluded that they were going to accuse Jesus of blasphemy because he said he is the Christ who's come from God. They're going to accuse him of blasphemy. But Pilate doesn't ask Jesus anything about that. Okay? And the reason Pilate doesn't ask Jesus about that is because the Pharisees have not even mentioned that to Pilate. And because of the fact that Pilate wouldn't even care if that were the case. And that's probably why the Pharisees haven't said anything. You know, Pilate would say, okay, he thinks he's God. Okay, that's weird, but I'm not going to put him to death because of that. And so Pilate doesn't hear that accusation. But Pilate is concerned about one thing, because Jesus has a lot of influence. And there's a lot of people who consider him very important and follow him and listen to his teaching. And so the only thing that Pilate is concerned about, the only thing he wants to know, is if Jesus might be planning any kind of a rebellion against Rome. Because if he loses control of this area, you know, he's going to lose his job. He doesn't want to lose his job. And so that's why I asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He wants to know if he's going to start an uprising. And so Jesus answers him in verse number 34. Jesus answered him, "Are you speaking for yourself about this, or did others tell you this concerning me?" And I love that answer because it flies in the face of just who Pilate is. Understand, Pilate is here asking Jesus, and we know why Pilate is interrogating Jesus, right? Because he's being put under pressure by the Pharisees, right? Because he's afraid they're going to go complain to his boss, Caesar, and he might lose his job or get in trouble with Caesar. So he's afraid, and so he's going ahead with this trial of a man who doesn't have any evidence against him, this man who doesn't have any witnesses, any reliable witnesses at all. He goes ahead and does this, and so he asks Jesus, he says, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus says, "Are you asking me this for yourself, or did somebody else tell you this?" Jesus turned it around. And so Jesus comes into this kind of trial courtroom situation, and you've got the judge up there. He's supposed to be the judge. And he starts asking Jesus, are you a king? Are you trying to get Israel? Are you going to try to lead Israel out from under the authority of Rome? And Jesus says to him, "Are you asking me that because you're concerned, or did somebody tell you that? And that's why you're in here." And so he takes the thing, he turns it around, and he puts the pressure back on Pilate. He's seeing if Jesus is any kind of... And we can begin to see here that the thing that Jesus is asking Pilate, it points in the face of what Pilate is. He's a spineless coward of a politician. Aren't you glad that our hands, that our future, that our happiness, that our lives do not rest in the hands of politicians? Yeah. And I don't care who they are, what side they're on. My happiness and my life, it doesn't rest in the hand of politicians. And I try to pick the best ones I can and vote for the best ones I can. But I'll tell you what, Jesus is going to say here in a minute, my kingdom is not of this world. And everywhere there's politics going on, there are going to be men like Pilate who can't make a decision, who are always going to be compromising, who are always going to be doing what they feel pressured to do. And here he is interrogating Jesus, saying, are you trying to start some kind of rebellion? And Jesus turns the question around. Pilate's supposed to be the judge here. He's supposed to be asking the questions, but Jesus turns it around, and all of a sudden Pilate's on the defensive. And you see in verse 35, Pilate answered, am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you to me. What have you done? And so Pilate's on the defensive here. And Pilate's basically asked, are you trying to lead some kind of revolution? And Jesus has turned it around and asked him, are you such a spineless coward that you have to do everything the Pharisees tell you to do? And so Pilate says, hey, wait a minute, I'm on trial here. They brought you to me, and I'm supposed to be asking you the questions. You see, it started out with Pilate thinking that he was the judge, but Jesus just simply opens his divine mouth, and just for a few seconds, he says a few majestic words, and all of a sudden, Jesus is the judge, and Pilate is answering the questions. And that's the way it's going to be in eternity. the way it's going to be on this earth one day. So verse 36, even though Jesus has brought him to this point, even though Jesus has pointed out, I know why you're doing this, because you're under a lot of pressure. You've got a tough job out there, you poor little guy. And it's tough to make these tough decisions. But Jesus answered. Jesus puts his mind at ease. He says, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now my kingdom is not from here. Okay, Pilate, do you really think I'm trying to start a rebellion against Rome for some kingdom here in this world? I don't need the scraps here. My kingdom's not of this world. He says, if so, then where are my soldiers? Because a king has armies and soldiers and servants that fight for him. And Jesus doesn't teach his men to rebel or to fight. He teaches his men to submit and to serve. Look, there's only one goofy guy on Team Jesus so far in this whole story that's pulled out a sword and started cutting people's ears off. And that was Peter. And as soon as he did that, Jesus healed Malchus's ear. And Jesus said, Peter, put your sword back in the sheath. The first sight of any kind of a rebellion, Jesus said, stop. There's no rebellion here. And so the accusation's gone forth, but it's fallen flat. It's an unwarranted accusation. Secondly, though this gets more powerful, I want you to see the unveiled revelation. Jesus is about to reveal to Pilate who he is. In verse 37, Pilate therefore said to him, are you a king then? And it's kind of the same question. Jesus has said to Pilate, my kingdom's not of this world. And that was enough to let Pilate know, even though he's not seeking to be any kind of a king down here on earth, yet he's still the heavenly King of Kings. Of course, as hardened as Pilate's heart is, and with all the false gods that the Romans worshipped, Pilate doesn't even begin to understand what Jesus means when he talks about the heavenly kingdom. So Pilate just latches on that word kingdom. And he asks Jesus one more time. He says, are you a king then? And I want you to listen to Jesus' answer in verse number 37. If you look at the text, I'm reading from the New King James Version. Maybe you have a similar one, but the New King James Version, Jesus answered, you say rightly that I am a king. And if you're reading from the New King James Version, which we have in our pew Bibles here, that doesn't mean they stink. That means they're in the pews. But he says, I've got jokes. Anyway, Jesus answered, you say rightly. And that word rightly, if you notice anything about it, it's in italics. Okay, and that means it wasn't in the original text. And so Jesus simply says to Pontius Pilate, he says, Pilate asks him, are you a king then? And Jesus says, you say that I am a king. Jesus is saying, he didn't say, you say rightly that I'm a king. Now, it doesn't hurt the translation for that to be there. It's there for clarity. But Jesus just says to him, you say that I am a king. And I want you to park for just a second on that word, you, in this sentence. Jesus says, you. He tells Pilate, you, this is something you're doing. Notice that. And then also want you to see the word say. And that word it's translated from the Greek word lega, which that word lega, it means to lay out the evidence for something through systematic discourse. It means that you are proving a case. And so what Jesus is saying to Pilate, the meaning of that word, he's saying, I don't have to go around claiming to be a king. I don't have to say that I'm a king because you're proving that I'm a king with every single thing that you're doing right now. And you say, well, how is Pilate doing that? And that's because Pilate is in the process of doing everything that the Word of God has prophesied would be done to the Messiah when he came. Read Isaiah chapter 53. In Isaiah 53, it prophesies about how by his stripes we would be healed. It prophesies about how he would be pierced and all the wounds. Psalm 22, another prophetic psalm where the Bible talks about his crucifixion. Hundreds and hundreds of years before Jesus was ever crucified, these prophets wrote, David and Isaiah. And everything it says Messiah would go through, all this suffering. And think about all the things that the gospel and everything that Jesus has been telling his disciples are going to happen to him. And you'll see that in everything that Pilate has done to Jesus here, and everything he's in the process of doing, Pilate is proving that Jesus is the perfect fulfillment of messianic prophecy. And Jesus looks at Pilate and he says, you want to keep asking me if I'm a king? I'm not the kind of king that you're thinking about, but everything you're doing right now is proving that I'm a much higher king than what you're thinking about. I am the king. Okay, and that's pretty cool, right? Pilate, you're proving it. But I want you to see something else. A little detail, but don't miss this. There's one more thing I want to show you here in verse 37. And it is a couple of words we've come across again and again and again as we've been studying through the Gospel of John, not Luke, right? As we've been studying through the Gospel of John, we have come across these two words by which Jesus calls himself, I am. And Jesus looks at Pilate here, Pontius Pilate, and Pilate's asking him, are you a king then? And Jesus says, you say that I am a king. And it's another time, it's another one, don't miss that. He's saying, you are proving here by everything that you're doing. You want to know if I'm a king? You are proving here by everything that you are doing that I am the I am king. That's what Jesus is making clear to Pilate. He says, Pilate, I know you're asking me if I'm a king, but you've got to think bigger than what you're thinking right now. I'm not a king like you. I'm not a king like Caesar. I am the I am king. That name by which God has called himself ever since that conversation with Moses at the burning bush. He said, you tell Pharaoh that I am hath sent you. And Jesus has been calling himself by this name. And even as he's going to the cross, he says, you say that I am a king. Thirdly, and quickly, we got to move because the Methodists are going to beat us the first if we don't hurry up. Thirdly, the unwanted invitation. That's number three. Now here's Pilate, he's the judge, and Jesus is about to extend an offer to him. Verse 37, he's been asking him if you're a king. Jesus says, you are proving by all this trial that you're putting me through, all this false report that you're accusing me of, you're proving that I am the I am king. And Jesus says in verse 37, for this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come into the world. How many times have we been through this gospel and seen Jesus say, I came down from heaven. I came into the world. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Jesus came down from heaven into the world to suffer and to pay the price for us. And Jesus says, he begins to say, he talk of why he came into the world. He says, for this cause I was born. For this cause I have come into the world that I should bear witness to the truth. And he says, everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. Now what's Jesus doing here? Isn't he sharing the gospel with Pontius Pilate? He's just told him that he's the I am king from heaven. And now he's told him that he came into the world for this purpose to bear witness of the truth that he's just revealed to Pilate. The part of that truth is all the suffering he's going through. And isn't that the heart of the gospel message of Jesus Christ? That Jesus Christ, the Son of God, came into the world to suffer on the cross for our sins. Did you mess up this week? Did you mess up in your life big time? It's okay, because Jesus already paid the price. Jesus paid the bill, and it's paid in full, and you don't have to do anything to purchase it. He paid the price with his precious blood, and that's the gospel message. And now here is Jesus. He's sharing this with Pontius Pilate, that I came into this world for this purpose, to suffer on the cross for our sins. And he says, and anyone who is of the truth will hear my voice. He's saying, if you will hear my voice and believe, you can be of a truth too. We can be saved. And here Jesus offers Pilate this gracious invitation to hear his voice. Everyone who's of a truth hears my voice. Now, park with me right here for a second, okay? Because I think there's something that needs to be said about that word hear. Jesus says, everyone that hears Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. And we may hear something, right? I think we all understand the problems that can be produced when someone is hearing, but they're not really listening, right? How many of you have children? And you understand what it means when they hear what you said, but they haven't listened, right? Okay. How many of you have a husband? So you know that too, right? Those of you who've been through this, and I think you can understand when Jesus invites Pilate here to hear his voice. You can be of a truth if you'll hear my voice. I think when Jesus invites Pilate here to hear his voice, he means more than that he wants the vibrations and sound waves that are coming out of his mouth to penetrate through the little holes in the ears on the side of his head. I think what Jesus means is that he wants his words to go into his mind, into his heart, and for him to believe. That's what he means when he says, they hear my voice. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice. Amen. They hear my voice. And Jesus is inviting Pilate to hear his voice. He said, I am that I am king, and I came here to suffer, and just what you're putting me through, it shows who I am. This is an awesome invitation by the man who's acting as judge over Jesus Christ. Jesus said, you got an opportunity right now, Pilate, to hear my voice. But I want you to look at how Pilate answered him in verse 38. Verse 38, Pilate said to him, what is truth? What is truth? And isn't that just the typical skeptical way in which the world responds to the truth of Jesus Christ, even still today? Been doing this forever. What is truth? How can you really know what's true and what's not? This sinful, fallen world and their desire to never be wrong about anything and their desire to never be told that they should or should not do something always wants to ask, how can anybody really know what is right or what is wrong? And I'll tell you the way we can know, because there is one God who created us, who reigns forever, and everything that He says is truth. And He has given us His Word, and His Word is truth. And I don't know all the experiences of your life or what brand of religion that you've been exposed to in your life. You may have been taught that every issue is debatable and has two sides. But I want to tell you today that there are some things that are just rock solid, unshakable, unchangeable, absolute truths that cannot be reasoned around with all the philosophy in all the world today. Truth is what God says it is, no matter what any man thinks about it. Amen. If you don't believe in absolute truth, then go home after church today and turn on the oven. Turn on the burner on the top until it's glowing orange hot. Please really don't do this, but just go home and turn it on until it's hot. And then when it's really glowing orange hot, you just stick your hand on there. And if you don't believe in absolute truth, I'm telling you of an absolute truth, it will burn you. Okay? It will burn you. Stick your hand on there. And I'm telling you of an absolute truth, you won't leave your hand on there very long. I'm telling you of an absolute truth, you will have to change your drawers. It's going to be bad. There are some things that are absolutely true. And here's the absolute truth. Jesus Christ is the only way to be made right with the Heavenly Father. It's absolutely true. Oprah may not think so, but I know so, because God's Word says it so. And I love Oprah, and I hope she comes to Jesus. But Pilate has his opportunity here. He's come to the time in his life when absolute truth is staring him in the face. You're going to see as we continue this through this that Pilate, even though he kind of gets defensive and he tries to defer it, he said, what is truth anyway? He's deeply bothered in his conscience about this. But he still doesn't have the courage to surrender to it. And so he tries to reason his way out of it. And he says, what is truth? Fourthly and finally this morning, we're going to see the unsuccessful substitution. That's our final point this morning. Verse 38, second part of the verse. When he had said this, he went out again to the Jews. Pilate had said, what is truth? He goes out again to the Jews outside who wouldn't come in the building because they didn't want to defile themselves by coming in that house, in that courthouse with all those Jews. Hypocrites. Hypocrites. So religious. They didn't want to defile themselves so they wouldn't be able to keep the Passover. They wanted their religious ceremony. And they didn't want to get defiled. They were so holy, but they're murdering a man. Hypocrites. And so Pilate goes out to them again. And he says to them, I find no fault in him. Now, wait a minute, let me read that again. I find no fault in him at all. And he's just trying to say that as strong, in as strong as the way he can. He could have just said, I find no fault in him. He says, I find no fault in him at all. I've questioned him and I'm questioning him again. And there's nothing wicked that this man has done. Jesus did nothing wrong. There's no fault in him, no crimes they could accuse him of. Because in order for the price of our sins to be paid, this is important, so that our sins could be paid for, only the perfect, innocent Son of God, the sinless Son of God, could be good enough to pay the price for my sins and your sins. And there may be some things that Pilate was confused about, but one thing he understands clearly is that Jesus is not guilty of any kind of crimes, any kind of sins. And so verse 39, watch what Pilate does. But you have a custom that I should release someone to you at the Passover. Do you therefore want me to release to you the King of the Jews? And so, understand at this point, Pilate is beginning to get very conflicted in his heart. He thought for a little while that maybe Jesus was maybe just a little crazy, lost his mind, was claiming to be God. But now that he's talked with him, he realizes there's something real, something compelling about Jesus. And he knows down in his heart it would be wrong to sentence this man to death. And so the right thing for Pilate to do would be go out there and say, no, you're wrong to do this. But this is all within God's plan. And so God had a man who was a compromising man in that position at that time. These Pharisees think they're in control of this thing. Pilate thinks he's in control of this thing. It's Jesus who's in control of this thing. Amen. Jesus is going to this cross on purpose. It's the Father's plan. And so this is where Pilate starts trying to compromise with the Pharisees. They're trying to pressure Pilate into having Jesus nailed to a cross. Pilate's afraid they're going to go complain to Caesar. He's going to lose his job, but as much as he wants to keep his job, he knows down in his heart it would be wrong to crucify Jesus. So being the compromising, weak politician that he was, he tried to compromise with him. And he brought out Jesus on one side, and he brought out Barabbas on the other side. And Barabbas was a violent criminal. He was, some historians have called him a terrorist that Pilate kept there in his little Guantanamo Bay type prison there. And he was looked upon as an enemy by the people of Israel. And Pilate thought, now surely the Israelites would never tell me to let Barabbas go. It would be kind of like bringing Osama bin Laden to America and saying we can let him go. That's what the choice they were faced with. And he thought he had his way out. Surely they'll never choose a terrorist like Barabbas. But the Pharisees were so filled with hatred for the Lord Jesus, their anger was so hot that they chose Barabbas, the terrorist, and let him go free. Verse 40, then they all cried again, saying, not this man, but Barabbas. It says Barabbas was a robber. And it all just goes to show you the kinds of foolish choices that wicked, sinful people, human beings can make. The wickedness of man goes deeper than we could ever begin to imagine. And we never see it more clearly than when the most religious people on planet Earth were given a choice between the holy, innocent, kind, loving Son of God and the worst kind of violent criminal, and they chose the criminal. They chose the violent killer. Yet at the same time, we also have here in this, think about it, a beautiful picture of the transaction that God made, the transaction that took place between God and man. God made possible for us through Calvary. Because in this scene that we're watching here, the most guilty sinner who's guilty of the most vile crimes, he goes free. But the innocent Son of God goes to the cross to suffer and bear the punishment for our sin. And don't you see, this is exactly the same thing that's taken place through Calvary. Because at the cross, the innocent Son of God suffered for our sins. And we, the worst kinds of sinners, were set free. You see, Barabbas, here in this story, Barabbas is a picture of you and me. We're the guilty ones. And he's made the decision that he would go. The innocent Son of God has made the decision that he would go and suffer and die and pay the price and bear the shame, and we would go free. That's what's taking place here. And we see a beautiful picture of it in Barabbas.